So let us begin. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being punctual. And we apologize because we are 5 minutes delayed. I am Rodrigo Filgueira. I'm a specialist in digitalization and vocational training. I work for ILO, Centerfor. And today we will have a special session with two presentations that are complementary. On the one hand, we are going to have Karine Zónigo, who's a specialist in digitalization and vocational training for the skills department of ILO in Geneva. Karine will be presenting on the outlook we have in terms of digitalization and vocational training, focusing on a very thorough, interesting document developed this year, which we will publish in Spanish very shortly. After Karine's presentation, we will have Marieke van der Weijer. I hope I pronounced it correctly. She's a senior analyst in developing skills for OECD, that's in Paris. And Marieke will share an experience, the experience of creating a digitalization assessment framework. Originally, it was meant for education and how it was adapted and applied in three European countries, Northern European countries. There's one thing in particular we're interested in. We would like to learn about the tool and how it can be adapted, the strengths and weaknesses of such a tool. And this is all part of a line of work that we have in ILO and Centerfor, which is a similar exercise. We are using the same tool, we are adapting that tool, and we are undertaking 5 pilot experiences in the region. And Marieke will talk about this tool called Selfie. And it's worked very well in that region, so we believe that we can really draw on that experience in a collaborative manner. And we are working with 5 institutions in focal groups. I will not go in more depth because that's the presentation. And let me simply tell you that both Karine and Marieke will be speaking English. So if you need interpretation into Spanish, please take a look at the bottom of your screen where you have a menu of options. You will find a globe, the icon of a globe, where it says interpretation, and you can change languages and you can choose the language of your preference. We have 2 interpreters working with us today, and they will be interpreting both presentations into Spanish. So please look for that icon if you need interpretation into Spanish. And I now give the floor to Karine. Are you ready, Karine? You have the floor.
Muchas gracias, Rodrigo. And buenos días a todos. Thank you very much for having me in this digitalization and maturity of TVET webinar. I'm gonna share my screen now. Can you see it? Okay. Okay, thank you. So as Rodrigo was introducing, I will take you through what the framework around digitalization of TVET looks like. But prior to that, I may take a step backward and introduce our global approach to digitalization in Tibet. And first, I will take you through the different areas of work, or should I say different aspects that we are looking at when talking about digital transformation in Tibet and skills development. So maybe here, I can say that, and I guess we are all aware that technologies are seen as a driver of change, but also as an enabler of transformative changes in skills development and Tibet, or in the labor market in general. And we often hear and often mix what I call the what and the how. And I'd like to synthesize a little bit what it's behind this. So technologies definitely do have an impact on the changing skills demand in the digital economies and societies, and this set of skills that are needed for individuals, businesses, institutions to be able to compete, to thrive in the digital economy and society. And here we are not only talking about purely digital skills, but we are talking about core skills and technical skills as well. And this is what I call, you know, the what and what type of impact technologies have on the labor market and the related skills needs for individuals. Now, technologies also have an impact on skills development and Tibet systems alike. This sector also has to undertake its own digital transformation. And it's not only, even if the focus has been put mainly during the COVID-19 pandemic and in the following months of the crisis, even though the focus has been put on design and delivery of training and skills development opportunities, the Tibet system includes much more areas and high-level functions than only the design and delivery aspects. And here I will mention, but I will deep dive a little bit more on that in a few minutes. I will mention those five high-level functions that you can see here, which are the impact of of technologies on the anticipation, planning, and monitoring function of a skills system. Their impact on, as I said, design and delivery, development of skills, but also certification and recognition of skills. Technologies also have an impact on the access to skills development and the labor market for all, as well as the function that helps providing skills for employability, decent work, and productivity. So again, really the technologies do have impacts and are driving changes, positive changes, we need to look at them that way, both on the changing skills needs and demand in the labor market, and the skills that individuals need to be developing to be able to thrive in the digital economy and society, and how the system itself need to undertake, you know, its own transformation to be able to cope and function in the digital era. And of course, a key aspect, and this is the fifth high-level function, is anything that has to do with governance and this enabling environment that you can see here, the policies, structures, and resources that enable an inclusive and sustainable skills development. And of course, the transformation of the skills needs and how the system is transforming itself will have an impact on, you know, policies and strategies or resources that are put in place. And this has to be considered in a very dynamic manner because of the the very nature of technologies which are evolving in a very, very fast pace. If we are looking specifically before moving to the TVET system digital transformation itself, if we are focusing a little bit on the what I call the what, the changing demand for skills in the digital economies and societies. And the ILO has published recently a publication on this specifically that you can see here. There's a critical need to conduct and use this, you know, anticipation and matching function to conduct some assessment on the skills that are needed in the digital economy and society. And I'm mentioning here a few of the ILO approaches to it, like the skills for trade and economic diversification STED, or the skills foresight here, or some other type of rapid assessments skills in the digital economy. It is critical for TVET providers and TVET institutions to make sure that we are updating curricula and creating new ones according to some new specialties and subject matter that needs to be added to it. It's critical as well for TVET institutions to be able to maintain and upgrade their equipments. The way they are, you know, delivering training, it's not the same type of equipment in a TVET institution, for example, to deliver mechanics or e-mechanics or, you know, green vehicle type of engineers. So really the idea is to make sure that those assessments are nurturing, or should I say are giving the data which is necessary to update those curricula, upgrade those, you know, TVET institutions, and of course equip our trainers to be able to deliver those type of skills that are needed in the digital economy. And that definitely requires flexible and dynamic mechanisms, as I said, because of the fast evolving nature of technologies. You know, an assessment one day will very soon be outdated. So it's very important to have those flexible mechanisms in place. And I'm mentioning here one of the mechanisms for sustainability that the ILO is putting in place, which are the sector skills bodies, which allow this assessment of the demand side in the digital economy. And that makes sure that for some specific sectors and occupations, we are gathering, you know, key stakeholders, such as, you know, the industry, the employers, the social partners, who have a role to play in defining those skills that are needed and which type of impact is this has on the demand side and the supply side to make sure that they are aligned. And of course, the importance of public-private partnerships in that regard. Now I'd like to switch and move on to what I called a bit earlier, the how. And so how technologies impact skill systems and TVET and skill systems. And in that framework that Rodrigo was referring to, which is the one that you can see on the screen, digitalization of national TVET and skill system, harnessing technology to support lifelong learning. We've tried to synthesize, or at least give a generic representation of those five building blocks. So these five areas that I've just introduced you to, those five high level functions of the skill system, and studied and looked at how technologies are impacting or driving change in each of those areas or high level functions or building blocks, as we call them in the framework. And within this framework, just to give you a brief overview, we are first describing what are those building blocks and the key processes that are, you know, linked to all of them, as well as describing which type of impact. So what does that mean, for example, for the development of skills and training? What does that mean in terms of using technologies to deliver or design training, or using technologies to anticipate better skills needs? And so we really looked at those different building blocks, look at the technology's impact on each of them. And we've tried in this framework to also share some relevant yet adaptable digitalization models and guides to make sure that whenever a country at a national level or a TVET institution is willing to undertake its own digital transition in any of these areas, they have some appropriate, you know, tools and models that they can rely on and possibly adapt. We also give in this framework some initial implementation guidelines, some key aspects that government agencies or TVET institutions should look at whenever they plan to undertake such a transition. And we've put together as well policy recommendations through a policy brief based on this specific framework. So that's the broad overview of what the framework is. Now, to come back to those five building blocks or high-level functions of the skill system that I've introduced, I may deep dive a little bit more on each of them. So when it comes to the anticipation, planning, and monitoring of skills development function of the system, here, we should say that in order to respond, to be able to respond to the digitalization challenge as a whole, it is critical, as you all know, that skills anticipation and matching system are strong or being strengthened. And all that has to do with the analysis of the skills demand and the labor market demand, the gathering of this data and information, the planning around skills development, as well as publishing, giving access to this information, visualization type of tools of such information and data is really what happens in this technologies really have an impact on this function because of the fact that it's utilizing, gathering, centralizing, visualizing a lot of data. And technologies are really an enabler in that matter. So, for example, the ILO is looking at how big data can be leveraged to strengthen anticipation and planning and monitoring of skills development, how we can look at online job vacancies or online profiles and applications to look into the skills demand as well as the supply side. So that's one of the high level function of the skill system where technologies can have a positive impact to strengthen this high-level function of anticipation and matching in a skills system. The second one I'd like to go through again briefly with the time that we have is the design, delivery, and certification of skill specific function. So as I said, it was definitely the key focus of governments, TVET institutions, even individuals, education and training throughout the health crisis that we've all been through. However, we all had some type of very short-term panic responses to it, whereas now it's really, you know, time to take a step backward and to look at this function as well as the others in a more strategic manner and have a more, as I often say, needs-based approach than a solutions-based approach. And really look at leveraging technologies for good whenever and only whenever it adds value to the learning experience, to the teaching experience, to the pedagogical goals, and so on and so forth. And in here, we are looking at impacts of technology or use of technologies such as immersive technologies, extended reality technologies, collaborative learning or collaborative technologies, how artificial intelligence and machine learning are, you know, enhancing the learning experience, training or trainees tracking the adaptation or learning adaptive mechanisms to make sure that we are serving to the learners relevant, you know, type of courses depending on their performance, their needs, their aspirations, their interests, or how, you know, they've performed in the previous course, for example. And so we are really looking at the transformation of design and delivery, as well as certification. And for example, for certification, we're looking at online credentials, badges, how certification can be made available online, and so on and so forth. We're looking at technologies such as blockchain to be able to leverage technologies for portability of skills as well in some specific areas. And so here again, the idea is to see what are the technologies that are being leveraged and make sure that we are leveraging them for good. And of course, there are things to be considered. So for the design and delivery function, for example, it is definitely key to look at continuous professional development for teachers and trainers in order to be able to understand what technologies can bring to the table and use those technologies really to enhance the experience and only for that. It is critical to also consider how, you know, roles and responsibilities for teachers and trainers or for, you know, TVET institutions, staff in general are changing. And look also not only at roles and responsibilities, but how processes are undertaking or undergoing some radical changes as well. In this building block here on access to skills development and the labor market for all, we're really looking at, you know, technologies that allow maximizing access to skills development and the labor market. So we're really looking at, you know, how technologies, for example, for people with disabilities can, you know, enhance their access and their engagement and participation in skills development and the labor market, such as with the use of assistive technologies, for example. We're looking at how different modalities, devices, how connectivity has an impact on access to skills development and the labor market for all. We're also looking at the competency and how, you know, learners and teachers need to be develop their own, you know, skills on how to use those technologies to access skills development and the labor market for all. We're also looking at, and this is what I've mentioned here as well on screen, we're also looking at any mechanism that can be also taken online thanks to technology and bring a bit more flexibility on anything that has to do with the recognition of, you know, informal, non-formal learning, and make sure that with mechanisms such as online portfolio, for example, or assessing some of the acquired skills, prior acquired skills, sorry, can happen remotely, for example. And here, we're looking at the impact, again, of technologies on how to provide those skills and capabilities for employability, decent work, and productivity. So here, of course, within any policy, there are different measures to develop employability. They, of course, become the main focus, whether that be in or beyond TVET institutions, skills development for employability. Really, the idea in this function is to improve the chances to access employment. So it is anything that has to do with career guidance, career education, tutoring, vocational support, access to employment or opportunities. And a work-based learning, such as, you know, traineeship, apprenticeship. And the idea here is to strengthen and make it possible to for individuals to go through, to develop their own, you know, career management skills through online career guidance services and tutoring and vocational support. And definitely, technologies, digital technologies, have a significant and growing role in that, and do have a growing role in providing those links between the technical education, the technical and vocational education and training, TVET, and workplaces, and that's also a critical aspect. Last but not least, and I mentioned that earlier, the legislative base, the policy framework that we need to make it happen and provide this enabling environment to make sure that skills development is inclusive and sustainable in time. And this has to do with national platforms, resourcing requirements, skills development, connectivity, and that definitely requires, you know, several key governmental agencies to work together across ministries type of undertaking and approach to make sure that, for example, labor, finance, economy, IT, digital transformation agencies are working together to make sure that the TVET and skills development system is strong enough to be able to respond to this changing demand in the digital era. So briefly, what does that mean for TVET systems and institutions?
We need to, you said briefly. We really need it briefly. I'm very sorry.
No worries. Very briefly, in this framework that I was referring to, we are really looking at how digital transformation of TVET institutions and those different stages of digitization, digitalization, and digital transformation. And I may not cover it all because I'm conscious of time, Rodrigo, really require a redefinition of roles and tasks, and as well as capacity development. Just to briefly take you through the strategic approach to the digital transformation, it is key and necessary to go through assessment of the e-readiness of the ecosystem. So whenever it comes to undertake this digital transformation at the TVET institution, it is critical to look at what infrastructure looks like, what teachers' capacity looks like, what learners' capacity looks like, what content and pedagogical approach look like, and self-reflect and assess those in a relevant manner. And Marieke is going to take you through one of those tools that can help, you know, self-reflecting and assessing those type of things in a TVET institution. Then, of course, the idea is to analyze the business needs, again, needs-based approach and not solution-based. Define properly a strategy. Of course, you cannot undertake the digital transformation, all of the key areas and high-level functions, but the overall picture is key to have, to make sure that whenever you are undertaking a transformation in some of the functions, that interoperability and integration is made possible. And of course, the importance is to measure and evaluate to make sure that then you can reassess and make it work. And as I said, building the capacity and managing the change are critical. I'll finish here with just mentioning briefly the five key principles within this transformation. To have, as I said earlier, TVET integrated systems, to have or to keep social inclusion as a key focus in any digital transformation strategy, to make sure that we are using solutions based on the needs that we have assessed and that are specific to TVET, that all of this is, you know, looked at and that change is managed. And of course, that we are looking at developing the capacity of any of the stakeholders involved. Thank you very much, Rodrigo, and sorry for taking too much time. Over to you.
Dear Karin, thank you from our side also for generating this summary of what is a document that we are now translating to Spanish, and it's around 190 pages already. So it's probably very difficult. You did a wonderful job summarizing this. I'm very sorry we didn't have much time. I'm going to leave you now, so we move forward fast with Marieke. Marieke, the floor is yours. You can introduce the subject yourself. So I don't take any more time. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Rodrigo. Let me just share my screen. Voila, here it is. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present our ongoing work on innovation in VET here today. So what I'll be presenting is a pilot of a survey that we are running. So a very new survey that we are doing in three countries at the moment, Estonia, Norway, and Scotland, so the United Kingdom, to look at innovation and particularly at the use of technology in VET or vocational education and training. But before I go into what that survey looks like and some first results as well for you, I'll tell you a bit of why we thought it was important to do that survey, why we did the effort of developing that survey. So last year, or it's almost 2 years ago, actually, we did some work on teachers in vocational education and training. And one of the topics that we looked at in that analysis is to see the extent to which teachers use or are ready to use innovative teaching methods, but also new technologies. And when we started doing that work, we immediately saw, well, there's actually not a lot of data on this. So we don't know much about what teachers do in terms of technology use in the classroom. So our first source to go to was, of course, our own data at the OECD. We have the TALIS data set, which is the Teaching and Learning International Survey. So it's a survey of teachers across many countries, but it focuses on lower secondary education. So it's typically the level before you go into vocational education. So it doesn't tell us much for vocational teachers. So we really had to do some efforts. And a few countries, the survey is administered also in upper secondary education. And in some of those, you can look at vocational education. So you can see here in this chart, in fact, it's only the case for six countries that we managed to get a sufficiently large sample to say something about vocational teachers. And here, for example, this chart, you can see the share of teachers who let their students use ICT for projects and classwork frequently or even very often. What you see is, based on those six countries at least, vocational teachers make more use or let their students use more technology, although in some countries it's more or less the same. What you also see is quite different, big differences between the countries. So in Slovenia, you have close to 60% of the vocational teachers who say that they let the students use ICT quite a lot, compared to 80% in Denmark and in Portugal. So there's something in the data, but the coverage is fairly low. Other interesting questions in that data, for example, here is the extent to which the teachers say that they can support their students in using technology in the classroom. And here you see that quite a lot of teachers actually struggle. So you see, for example, in Sweden, you have about 40% that say, well, I can only do that to some extent, or I can actually not do that at all. It's a lot lower, that share, for example, in Portugal, but interestingly, quite a big share of teachers in some of the few countries that we have here. And a last interesting question that came from this survey that we looked at is the share of teachers who say that they have a need for training in ICT skills. In fact, that question is asked for a whole range of skills in this TALIS survey, and ICT skills are certainly the one that where most teachers require or say to require training. You can see that here in a country like Portugal, where on the contrary, in the previous slide, you could see that most feel relatively comfortable here. They do say, well, 60%, they have quite a high need for training in ICT skills. And it's quite high in all of the countries. So Turkey, the lowest one here in the chart, it's also still 40%. So a few interesting insights and certainly worth looking into further, but very limited data coverage. And that spurred us to look at alternative sources. So what we looked at then, or what we came across, is the selfie tool. And that's, I'll tell you a little bit about this. So the selfie tool is not an OECD tool, so I'm definitely not the expert. It's developed by the European Commission. And it is a tool actually for self-assessment. And we've just heard about that as well. So to see for teachers, for students, for schools, to what extent do I make use of technology and do I do it in an efficient way? So you can see here, it's an anonymous tool that gathers the view of students, teachers, and school leaders on how technology is used in their school. And it covers many different topics. It's a 30-minute survey, if I'm not mistaken, covers things like leadership, collaboration, infrastructure in the schools, professional development for the teachers, the students' digital skills. So it covers quite a lot of ground, and it really helps the teacher in the school to see where are we in terms of digital technology use, where are the gaps, where can we go, what is next for us. It's being used around the world. So it's not only for EU countries, it's open to all countries, and that's also why we thought it was particularly interesting to see what happens in OECD countries. So it's available at different education levels as well, so primary, secondary, vocational, and since recent also work-based learning. Unfortunately, we haven't managed to look at that yet. It's quite new. So very interesting tool for schools, so very useful in itself, but also useful for the purpose that we had in mind. So what we wanted to look at is, what does the data coming out of that tool actually tell us? So it's all anonymous. And indeed, we only got access to some very high level aggregate data, but still it gives us a bit of insights on where technology is being used and what some of the challenges are. So here is one chart that we managed to produce, and you can see there's a very long footnote because, of course, this selfie tool was never really designed to be a data collection tool. It was really designed to help schools. So there's a lot of caution when interpreting what you see if you look at the respondents in terms of representativeness, et cetera, but still some interesting insights here. You can see quite a high share of teachers who say that they are indeed using digital technology in the classroom, mostly so to engage students and to foster their creativity, but also, for example, to assess their skills. Useful as well in these data that we got from the European Commission is that you can look at the characteristics of the teacher. And here we could look, for example, at age. So we see very clear pattern. The older the teacher is who responded to the selfie questionnaire, the less likely he or she is to use technology in the classroom. There's also questions in selfie about how comfortable the teacher feels in using technology. And here you see the proportion of teachers using the tool who say, I feel confident or very comfortable, confident using digital technology for various activities. It looks high, but you have to look at it at, from the inverse, I think. So you can see that there's still a quarter of teachers who really don't feel comfortable using technology. And I haven't put this the slide here, but we have the same chart by age. And you can see that steep pattern again, the older teachers feeling definitely less confident using technology in the classroom. Then selfie also has a host of questions more on support, so enabling factors, maybe we can call them. And there's some interesting insight on that as well. So for example, half of the teachers say, I do get support from the school or from the school leader to try new things. I do get time off to work on these things. So those are interesting insights coming as well from the selfie tool. So definitely a useful tool both for schools and in terms of kind of research projects. But unfortunately, again, very high level data. So that's one of the constraints for us, at least, that we couldn't get access to data by country. We could, for anonymization reasons, of course, the data are not representative. No, maybe they're only the strong schools use the selfie tool. So we don't know that, of course. And then while there are a lot of questions in there, there's still a lot of things also that are not there. What we are particularly interested in for this research project is to understand a bit better what types of technologies are being used in schools. And here, selfie is relatively broad in its questions and it doesn't go into that level of detail. So that brings us to the survey that we developed a few months ago. It's still really very new. And this is a survey that we send to vocational education training providers, so schools or other training institutions in the three pilot countries that I mentioned, so Estonia, Norway, and Scotland. And what we want to look at here is really, as I said, what type of technology are you using? And also some insights into how they're using it. So we've identified a set of technologies that you can see here, online courses, immersive technologies, robots, AI, digital assessments, online meetings, and school information systems. We had to group a little bit. Obviously, we could have gone into even more detail, but that makes it quite difficult for the schools to reply. And then we look at topics such as to what extent do you use it? How many students benefit from it? At what level do you use it or in what setting? Why are you using it? What is the purpose? What is the reason for using it? How successful has the technology been? And very importantly, in terms of policy guidance, at least, what have been some of the barriers to the use, the adoption and the use? As I said, it's been sent to the VET providers, and it was open to them to choose whether it would be a school leader or one of the teachers replying. So the survey has been inspired by selfie, definitely, but also by a research project in the Netherlands on technology use in vocational education. So just a few preliminary insights, and they're really preliminary. This is really still based on a relatively small number of respondents, but just to give you a flavor of what we are seeing, what is coming out of it. So here is in terms of the share of respondents who say that they use a particular technology. You can see across the three countries, very high reported use of digital tests, digital assessments. for me, actually quite a surprising finding. Also, quite a lot of use of online meetings, online courses as well, although less so in Norway. And then you see school information systems being rolled out, I say, in Estonia and Norway very widely, but less so in Scotland. So this kind of made us think about what could be behind that. In fact, Scotland is a very privatized, liberalized market of training providers. So there's a lot of small private sector providers. And these school information systems are usually kind of imposed top down, let's say, by big schools or by the government in one big type of shared system, which could explain why in Scotland it's not used as commonly in by those smaller providers. Likewise, you see robots, for example, it's quite a big investment to make use of robots in your school, something that maybe those small providers in Scotland are not able to do. I'm just speculating here, of course, in the next kind of type of, this is a pilot, and hopefully when we improve it, we'll be able to ask more questions about that. So let me zoom in particular now on Norway, just to make it a bit more easy to represent, and also it's the country where we received so far the biggest number of responses. Here you can see what they're using the technology for. And it's obviously not surprising, online courses, immersive technology, robots, AI, it's more used to deliver the actual training. Assessments obviously used to assess skills, and virtual meetings and schools information platforms are more a communication tool. A very interesting question and a very positive one is as well, as you look, if you look at the responses here, if you ask them, the teachers, the leaders, the ones who replied, was the technology successful in meeting its objective? You see an overwhelming positive reply. So you have a strongly and somewhat agreed for all of the technologies. It's really the big majority. So that's very hopeful, very encouraging. And we hope to be able, depending on the number of responses that we get, to look a bit deeper into order differences by field, differences by size of school, etc. Last chart that I wanted to show is on the barriers. As I said, this is an important one for us to look then also at the policies. So if you look at the barriers most often reported in the survey, we see that teacher skills or lack of skills among the teachers is a big one, a big barrier across the different types of technologies. And that's consistent effect with the selfie data and with the Thales data. So quite a big share of the respondents say the reason that it wasn't adopted or is not being used effectively is because teachers do not have the necessary skills. Another big one is, of course, financial constraints, and that's especially the case for those advanced technologies like immersive technologies, robotics, artificial intelligence. What I also find interesting in this chart is that for some technologies, and again, for the most advanced ones, this is mostly the case, some of the teachers say it's too dependent on our own initiative or the school leaders. So it's too dependent on the person who's in the classroom. And this could point to some lack of institutional or strategic support for adopting these technologies. So some very interesting insights, but also still a lot of work for us to go to the next step with this pilot. There's interesting things we see, but we need to be able to understand better what is behind it. We need to have a bigger, much bigger coverage in terms of the respondents. And this is something if at the ILO, if you are considering doing something similar, I think for us, that's been the most challenging. I think that the schools, they get plenty of requests to answer to surveys. So to keep it simple for them, not too resource intensive, and to still get sufficient number of replies, it's not so easy. But just for you, just to conclude, we want to, of course, complement these data with also information on the policy side, information on good practices to get more detail into what this actually looks like. And this is very similar to what we just heard from Karine in terms of the areas of technology use, or at least the purposes. So this is our framework, which is very close to what we've just seen from the ILO. So technology use and for engaging learners, engaging employers to train and to overcome some of these barriers, but also for management and communication. So to communicate between the employer who is offering training and the student itself and the school. And then in terms of assessment. So here we plan to look at policies, to look at practices that then complement the data that we are collecting. So that is it for me. Here are some two of the reports, a report that I referred to on teachers that was kind of the starting point for us to look at this more deeply, and then some work more on general education, but with some very interesting insights of what technology could do. I'll give it back to you, Rodrigo. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maria. It was very interesting and also very useful to also confirm some of the pros and cons that we see in this tool, in the work we are also doing. I wanted to comment just a couple of things in English, because it's for you, actually, and then I'll switch to Spanish for the questions. No, I don't think that's a good idea. The questions will also be in English, so I'll need to translate. I just wanted to mention that in terms of the getting a good representation, getting schools to participate, one of the things we've achieved in this application of SELFIE in the region is that SENAI, the National Service for Training in the Industry in Brazil, has adopted a part of this method, the adapted version, for their evaluation framework of centers. So they're applying a pilot now on 200 centers, of over 500 and something. But this is the first time they're doing it. So we may be able, and I believe, and I see a question from Carlos de León from Intercap, that also Intercap will do quite a representative assessment during next year of the whole number of centers that they have. So that may be an interesting opportunity to look at that process together. I do have one question here that I think I can answer myself, but I can allow you for you both to comment in. There's a question on, for online evaluation, how do you make sure that all the types, kinds of learning that happen in the competencies, in the skill set, where cognitive, procedimental, right, attitudinal things that have to do with behaviors, attitudes and values. How do you assess that online? And I think my answer in the frame of this webinar is that this is not what SELFIE says. Each center may eventually do this or do it a different way, right? You would agree with that. I mean, there's no way we can answer from SELFIE if institutions are actually assessing the labor competency, one would say, integrated, right? Okay. And then there is another question from Carlos de León. This is, why does the use of technology seem higher in vocational training, technical training, than in education in general? What's your hypothesis in that regard?
If I can.
Yes. Okay.
Well, the data are a bit... It's only a few countries, of course, and it's hard to draw conclusions, but in terms of why it's higher in technical programs, you can think, of course, that it could, to some extent, be where it's most needed. Think about simulators that you can use in schools to really give learners the opportunity to develop these work-based skills or these labor or employment-relevant skills these technologies are very important. Not saying that in general education technology is not important, but in vocational education, you can immediately see virtual reality, recreating your workplace. That's something that can really help us make vocational education better. So in that sense, it's possible that schools have first looked at those technologies, but I'm definitely speculating here. On the other hand, you could say online learning in vocational education, well, that's really challenging, and we've seen that during the pandemic. In that sense, general education will be much more advanced than vocational education. So it depends a bit on the definition of technology here, but there could be something behind it. And if I can, on the assessment, I fully agree with you, Rodrigo, that's way beyond what SELFIE tries to do. Mm-hmm. But if your question is more about to what extent could online assessment be something in the future, there are definitely challenges. It's the same as with online learning. How do you do this practical component in an assessment? But it's also something we are looking at. I think I can announce that we're doing a PISA for vocational education, or at least starting to develop it. And in that sense, we'll also be looking at how can we assess practical skills through a computer-based test? How can we assess these employability skills? So there are definitely advancements in those areas in terms of simulated environments as well. But it's a complicated area, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, Marek. Karin, you have your hand raised.
Yeah, very quick to just follow up on what you said, Marieke, on the reason that may explain why technologies are more used in vet environments. And one of the things that may also explain is the financial aspect that you have mentioned, Marieke, on the fact that, and we saw that in some different TVET institutions in Africa, for example, where the linkage or the collaboration with the industry and the private sector makes it or facilitates the financial investment of TVET institutions in those, you know, automated, extended reality type of technologies and so on. Which may not be the case in education or traditional education that was referred, or general education that was referred to. So maybe the financial aspect in some cases is also the reason why it makes it, you know, more extended and used. Thank you.
Okay. I don't have any more questions. I do have one question that came through different channels, WhatsApp, and it's for you, Karin. You went through the four pillars, but there was the one underneath it all that had to do with governance. And we have different models of governance in the region. We have models that are actually monolithic, that take care of everything, some mixed and some simply in a way facilitate and control the demand and supply of vocational training in the market through private providers. The question that had to do is, how do you see this happening, this process of digitalization happening over systems for these different kind of models? What either warnings or opportunities?
So in terms of opportunities, to take the positive aspect first, technologies can definitely be seen as I said, an enabler or facilitator in terms of sharing experiences, best practices. We are looking at, for example, different digital strategies within different systems. And really, again, the idea is not a one size fit all. So really the idea is, through technologies, have a centralized space where, and technology enables that to mutualize, but also share and adapt depending on this variety and diversity of systems that you are referring to. So I would say that technology has a role to play in that, and that we should definitely leverage it when it comes to, for example, sharing curricula and online resources and courses that, you know, can be used by different TVET institutions, for example. And in that, technology has a role to play. When it comes to the drawbacks or maybe limitations, I would say that it's a bit of the same response. It means that, unfortunately, we need to be looking at the exact needs and structure of each of the system to make sure we adapt the strategy around it. So again, one size, you know, does not fit all. And really the idea is to have those building blocks, as I recall them, but, you know, any type of high level functions, and really adapt them to the needs and the different systems in place. Not sure if I understood or if I took your question correctly or not.
I think so.
Your question, but hopefully I answered the audience questions. Yes, yeah, sorry for that, Rodrigo.
I thought it had to do with what actually Marieke mentioned regarding Scotland. Where you have that, it may have to do with that, because we are promoting this idea of having an assessment. Some institutions see it as something that it's integral when you're monolithic and you can control all the variables. And then we think also that it's very useful for a central authority to actually assess what's happening in the private market and demand quality. Also, I thought it had to do with that, but thank you. In any case, it was very interesting. There's a question here that refers to if we know about technology being used to assess labor contexts, right, to certify the not just recognition of prior learning, it could be in the frame of a traditional course, right? Do you have examples? I do have a couple here in the region. One has to do with, I lost the name in English, soldadura. What's the name? Welding, that's the name. Welding simulators that actually allow you to assess a lot of the process, although the law in general requires that you do it face-to-face at least a certain amount of hours. And also some in construction, in security and safety at work in construction in Colombia. The first one we recently saw it in Guatemala, in Pacap. But I don't know if you have some examples in mind.
Yeah, I had exactly the same type of examples, like welding industry and construction. And another one that we saw recently in Asia was with the tourism and hospitality industry, where on different aspects, whether that be, you know, food and beverages or travel agents, we had remote assessment using technologies, whether that be using sophisticated ones or high-tech ones, such as extended reality, augmented reality, and virtual reality, or simply or more simply using annotated videos and videos that learners would share with assessors on those specific occupations in the tourism and hospitality industry.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Well, for our work on this PISA-VET assessment, we are trying to gather some good practices from around the world. Germany has done quite a lot of investment in the ESCOT initiative. First, they've for a few occupational areas developed online assessments. It's very much like the two of you are saying, for those very technical things, like in German case, it's car mechatronics. They have simulations where you need to operate the engine in an online environment. For some other areas like healthcare, they also have some assessments, but it's more, there's a video and you need to respond, like, what would you do in this situation? So it's quite different depending on the occupational area. We've also seen a nice example of a video platform, something similar to what you mentioned, Karine, where students can upload what they do, how they do it, and then there's a host of assessors who assess them. So there's interesting things emerging, but what works in one area or sector would not necessarily work in the other.
I think while Karine was responding and I was thinking about what you said also, Maria, regarding how difficult it is to think about assessment in terms of using technology. I think this question can be linked to the previous question regarding, are we able to assess online the whole context, all the pieces, cognitive, procedural, plus behavioral? And what we generally see is tools that will allow you to assess the technical part of it. Right. So if we want to certify the whole competency, that may prove still some kind of further challenge to what's already in place. I don't see many more questions. I don't know if my colleagues, here through Teams, have any questions? Nope. In principle, I think we were able to answer to each and every question open and available in this regard. No, but I think it was really, really interesting. We kept a steady number of participants, so we were able to maintain interest, and I think that's particularly important in these times of one after the other online meeting. So I would thank you both and hope to probably we won't be seeing each other until next year. So I would say happy Christmas and all those things. And maybe for a last couple of words, if you would like to close on your side. Then I have 1 minute to ask something from the participants. Who would like to go? Karine?
Let's go. Yeah, sorry, Mike. First, thank you very much for having me. It was a pleasure to, you know, share the framework that we've worked on and also see that there is interest in it. And I'm very much looking forward to, you know, continue working together on this and more in the forthcoming, you know, weeks and months. So thank you very much. And thank you to all people who have joined today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, also from my side, thank you. This was really interesting also to learn about the work of the IU of Karine and to hear the examples, Rodrigo, that you mentioned, to hear the questions. So on our side as well, this is still a pilot, as I said, and it's all very preliminary, but we hope to publish some insights at least from this data collection in the first quarter of next year. We'll keep you posted on that, and we hope we can collaborate in the future.
Thank you, Marieke. Thank you, Karine. And then, Mateo. Mateo, if you would like to share the... there's a small survey. Le pido a los participantes, I will ask the participants to stay a minute and answer this this small survey regarding the webinar.
Rodri, están los micrófonos activados por si quieren saludar.
Okay, microphones are open for those who want to say goodbye. See you soon, and that would be it from my side. Thank you, everyone, very much. Muchas gracias a todos.
Muchas gracias. Saludos de Panamá.
Gracias. Saludos desde Colombia.
Un abrazo. Muchas gracias.
Saludos de la República Dominicana, todas y todos.
Gracias, sí, gracias. Saludos.
Gracias,
saludos
por la intérprete
Colombia.
En español.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias a Macarena, mi colega, que no la encuentro aquí. Gracias a los intérpretes.
Saludos a
desde
todos.
Colombia, desde Colombia, muchas gracias.